invite CH Venkatachalam to take over. Sir, the floor is yours.
Sir, you're on mute, please.
Oh, okay. Good evening, Mr. Yagarajan, our beloved finance minister of my government, Tamil Nadu government, my respected Professor Arun Kumar, beloved Mr. Gandhi and Mr. Dharanidharan and all the participants. I'm thankful to the organizers for this opportunity today, and I'm very delighted to be a part of this webinar. And I feel it's very important for people like us that we discuss this issue very seriously to create more and more awareness, because it's a very huge decision that the government has taken, just like that, to monetize the public assets that have been built up in our country over the years. And the central government, union government, has been doing this. And that's why I'm just tempted to quote one Thirukkural from the great Thiruvalluvar. Arimuga ondru ariyan eninum urudi ulai irundhan kural kadan. If the top man who is running the country, either he himself is not aware or not he is listening to people who know, then it is the duty of the minister to tell him properly what is good and bad. I think that's how I will begin the initiative being taken by our Tyagarajan sir in this regard. This debate is very important because the implications are very huge. First of all, at least I am a known leftist, and I am also a clear pragmatist. So I know the Indian reality when I talk on this issue. And I fully agree with the presentation of the learned Professor Arun Kumar. Very lucidly he has told what is all about. And we also know that we have the mixed economy in our country. I have no illusion that we are living in a socialist country. I know the reality is it's a mixed economy. And so both public sector will be there and private sector is also there. And both have a role to play. So it doesn't mean that when we talk of all these things that private sector should not be there. The reality is that they will be there, and I concede, but they have a role. But the point is that we are celebrating the 75th year of our country's independence, and last 70 years of planned economy is all before us. And public sector, all of us know, it has come out of necessity. It is not simply dogma, but out of necessity. Where private sector was not ready, that's where the public sector came. And that's why we find today the public sector has been built up in various basic sectors, core sectors, and huge investments have gone into that, and from public money, from the public exchequer, from the taxpayers' money. And both have an entirely different role to play. Public sector has a role to play. Private sector also, they have a definite role. And I believe that they are not comparable at all. Can we compare the contribution of Air India and Kingfisher and Jet Airways? So we can't. Air India has had a different role. We are going to see now what they are trying to do after Air India become Tata's. We'll be back to square one. Similarly, can we compare BSNL and Airtel? So these are all, Airtel has its own business and space, and they will do that and they will make money, no problem. But BSNL has a special role to play in Indian context. Similarly, government transport and also the private buses. So the motto itself is different. There the motto is the only profit for them. So I have no grudge on that. Let them make profit. But where service is required, where people are involved, naturally, only the public services have to be there. For example, you know, we have this IMF. They want developing economies to open up. We have the World Bank recommendation where they want the poor countries to restructure the economy. We also see the World Trade Organization, WTO, they want more liberal trade laws. We understand that. But we know why they want all these things, and we understand that. So they have their own logic. So similarly, can a government like India, are we not to talk about the people? Is exactly the point. Indian reality today is the bulk of the people are below poverty, or downtrodden people, marginal people, lower middle class, etc. The elite class is a very small segment. So this has to be constantly kept in mind whenever we talk of any economic policy in our country. We can't compare ourselves to developing countries like UK or America or Japan or Germany or Italy. It's completely different situation in India, where even today, after 74 years, we still have backwardness in some of these sectors. And so development is the priority. GDP growth is important, but GDP growth has to be equitable, and it must impact on the lives and living conditions of the common people. And who will contribute more, whether the government sector or the private sector? This is the question number one, I think, that we have to address. Second, we already have built up a huge public sector, public infrastructure assets, etc. And these are our family silver. Can we just like that sell them? Today we need money. We know there is shortfall for revenue, but doesn't mean that we have to sell the family silver built up in the last 7 decades with people's money. So if you sell them or lease them or monetize them or privatize them, who will get it? Who can, if you monetize, who will be the recipient or the beneficiary? Obviously the private sector. And one argument is that the public sector is not efficient. And so if you monetize them, you get revenue. At the same time, you just give it to private people, they will manage more. I think there is no empirical evidence as of now, after 1947, that public sector is inefficient and only private sector is efficient. You can't say that. There are wonderful, efficient public sector undertakings also. And if there are any loopholes in public sector, there are very valid reasons why they are in trouble. So it's not just to simply believe that monetizing, you get money. At the same time, they will manage these assets more judiciously. I don't think we can simply buy that argument. And if so, then why so many corporate failures in our country? You can just lift out so many corporate scams, and all types of failures have come. So how to believe that just now they have become so nice and they will take care of these assets? So that is also not a clear argument. At least I can talk from the banking industry, because I am in the banking sector for the past 40, 50 years, and I know it a little well. And we know the efficiency of this private sector or the corporate sector. Today, the only major problem in the banking sector is the bulging bad loans. We call it now NPA. I don't know how it is an asset, it's a liability. But the point is, who is the main contributor? Who is the villain of the piece? It is only the corporate sector which is contributing for the swelling bad loans in the banks. And now we want to believe that these people, they will manage all the public assets, people assets better. So I think that is not okay. We have recently the IBC, Insolvency Bankruptcy Court, where lot of people, delinquents, corporate delinquents, they have cheated the bank, they have cheated the country, cheated the people, and they have gone away. And they are being discounted and sold at a very cheap price, 70%, 80%, 90%, 95% discount. So this is the story of private sector in our country. And how to believe in this monetization pipeline that they will all be wonderful people and they will manage our assets properly? So coming to this another question of monetization, I believe it's simply a jugglery of word only. Monetization is nothing but privatization. Why there is no serious discussion? Because it's a huge decision the government has taken. Nothing was discussed in the parliament, no public debate, nothing. State governments have not been consulted. Just like announcement, they have said that all these public assets will be monetized. So this is number one question that people have to discuss, whether this government is so autocratic The Australia and a democratic country, just like that, they will take a major decision like this. Second, their argument is that this monetization of these public assets will help them to cater to the needs of the huge their project infrastructure pipeline. That's about 100 crores, 110 crores like that. But here we find, even according to them, admittedly, that per year it will be 1.5 lakh crores. In 4 years, it is going to be 6 lakh crores. So it's a pittance to what they require. And this is not the only remedy, that by monetizing the public assets, the whole country's infrastructure needs will be met. It is not so. Then they are talking of the assessed revenue. Even according to them, the declared assessed revenue will be around 1.5 lakhs crores per year. But these are all, these are not idle assets. Some of them all now, they are working assets, and already these assets are earning some revenue. So what they talk is that I will get a lease rent of 1.5 lakh crores per year on this. But if you minus the current revenue on these things, or if you utilize these assets properly, their net revenue will be negative. So it is not proper to simply put a list that this will get me so much money, that will get me so much money. Ultimately, it will be not net gain, it will be net loss. What they are not telling is, what is the current revenue that we are getting on the assets? This is also another very important point. There is no clarity on that. And why private people will come? When the government says, I am not able to manage it, these are idle assets, I will give it to somebody. Who is that somebody? That somebody will be obviously only the private hands. And why they will come in? Unless this is remunerative, this is profitable, why they will come? That means they will make a profit. And I'm a simple banker. All along my life, I've learned debit and credit should tally. So if there is a debit, there must be a corresponding credit. Similarly, if there is a profit to these people by monetization, that means somebody is going to lose. So it's very simple for me that if they are going to privatize by monetization, the country will lose, the people will lose, the government will lose. So it's as simple as that. And see, what they want to monetize, roads, train tracks, railway tracks, airports, harbors, stadium, gas line, gas pipeline, solar power assets, hydro power assets, warehouses, petroleum pipeline, telecom towers, power transmission assets. What is left out? I think except the people, everything is listed. That means everything is for sale. And this is the danger that we have to understand. Another impact, according to me, the public sector assets are a great stabilizer of price level in our country. It's very important. In India, prices and inflation is a constant issue. So if everything is private, and naturally this, the good role that is being paid by the public assets, public sector, of equalizing or stabilizing the price level will be lost. Then real estate will be impacted. The advantage will be lost, and the poor people will suffer from more and more price hike. And then we have to talk of employment in India. You can't wish away that. Even this government, 6-7 years ago, they came to power by promising that I will give you 2 crores jobs every year. But here, if you want to privatize all these services and then assets, it is going to impact on the employment. Even whatever employment will be generated will not be quality employment, will not be regular employment, it will be contractual jobs. So our Indian youth will be subjected to extreme exploitation. Then in India, still reservation policy is very, very valid. It has to be there. So if it is public sector, then we have the reservation policy. If it is private, then you know what will happen. So we are running the risk of jeopardizing the interest of the people who are today guaranteed the reservation in jobs. And there'll be monopoly of goods and services. So these are all not good at all for our people. This is simply a shortcut. They need some revenue, we understand. But there are many other ways of discussing with the shares and people like Mr. Tyagarajan, they are very well aware, they are very vocal, they are very practical. There are a lot of finance ministers who are also aware of all these things. And instead of discussing with them, simply selling everything and then bridging your deficit in the budget, this is not going to help the country at all. It is going to be a long-term negative impact on the country and the economy. It is going to be disastrous. And that is why in India, which is a country where the poor people are more, we need to take care of them. Whatever we talk, whatever we do, ultimately, the center of everything must be the people, the people, the people. When we say the people, the common people, the ordinary people, the poor people in our country. If they are going to be negatively impacted, whatever may the policy that we talk about, I think we have to say no to that. That's why this is a very complicated policy. We can argue on merits and demerits of this monetization policy. Ultimately, when we are aware that this is not going to benefit the common people, it is going to negatively impact them, I think the government must revenue. People know politics in our country. Onion politics, they know. Potato politics, they know. But these such important macroeconomic policies are very important. Growth is important. Development is important. GDP is important. But ultimately, we need to worry about, constantly worry about equity, equality, and social justice. And all these will be affected adversely by this huge monetization of public assets. And that's why it's very important that we need to build up more and more awareness amongst the people, make a public debate so that the pressure is created on the union government, discuss before they plunge into anything that is happening now. I feel this government has only one medicine for all the diseases in our country. For every problem, this is the only solution they are giving. Privatization, PPP, whatever by different names is the latest name. And that's why I'm very happy that this Dravidian Professional Forum has taken up this issue today very rightly. And our Tyagarajan sir is also taking initiative. I'm very sure. And this will not be confined to the small debate today. It will widen. And people also will be able to be mobilized to safeguard what we have built up in the last 75 years. So thank you very much for the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us, sir. It's a pleasure to have you. And I couldn't agree with you more when you said it is the responsibility of the government to maintain equity, equality, and social justice, and also how PSUs are necessary for stabilizing of prices in the whole country.